So the next topic is recurrent neural network. And there's a very nice blog on the internet explain the recurrent neural network very well. So we use this blog to explain recurrent neural network, okay? So as we mentioned before, there's always some data which is not, which includes some time information like time series. So XT1, XT2, T3, T4, like they have corresponding value like temperature, like stock price, like your height to your weight, okay? They have time series data, okay? So most of the time, we like to predict what is the next value in this time series, right? So maybe you can use the x1 to xk as your input, and the corresponding y as the next value as your y. So you have a sliding window to walk across the history data to train the model to predict the next value, right? That is time series. But sometimes we have another type of value, as we mentioned before, called event sequence. So event sequence is not that time related, but the event which occurs in the previous time and the next time, they have a sequence. They are not necessary to be time series data, but they have sequence. And again, sometimes we need to analyze a sequence analyze a sequence to predict next sequence, or we need to aggregate all the events to come up a result to perform a classification. So we'll show you several different scenario to use sequence data, okay? So before we start, okay, we'd like to show you this figure. That is a very common figure when we talk about time-related neural network, okay? So in the previous explanation, okay, we have several different neurons. And we use these neurons as information, as the input information, and we use a dense neural network to connect them together. So basically, it really doesn't matter you put your weight or height at x1 or x2, because those structures are symmetric. You can put your weight, you can put all your weight in x1 or in x2. It really doesn't matter, because all the information will be passed to the next hidden neurons, right? And those x1 to xm, they don't have any structures to describe the time information about them. But usually, okay, when we encounter time series data or event sequence data, okay, that looks something like that. You cannot exchange their position because it is meaningful, right? Because it is meaningful. So we need another structure to analyze this. So that means every time when you have your input, okay? So then you input the data. And for a certain kind of calculation, okay, calculation. And this means after this calculation, you will have an output right here. But you have to bring your history, which is right here, to your next input. So, sometimes I would draw this figure by using this fig, draw this fig in this way. Okay, you have your input xt, and you perform certain calculation a, and you have an output of this timestamp ot. And your history pass the information ht will be passed to your next stage with your next input. Okay, and usually, okay, we will write it in this way. Okay, I think that is more clear. Okay, so basically this figure is exactly as this one. We have x0 as our very first input, right? And after that you perform certain calculation and you output your O0, output 0, and all the information you want to pass to the next stage, and that is H0, that's another vector as well. So for the next calculation, you have your next observation, which is X1. And you should combine x1 and h0 by using a and output the corresponding o1. And again, you have to merge your past information h0 and x1 and produce h1 to the next stage, and you have next input x2 and T2. Do some calculation, output the value, and bring the information to the next stage, as so on and so forth, so on and so forth. And usually we call it a cell. And all the calculation right here is the same, and they have certain weight in this cell. And you might want to know, and what about this value? You can simply just input O0 vectors as the past information. That means no information about the past, and so on and so forth, so on and so forth. And usually, if it is a classification, if it is a classification problem, this value could be your y hat. Of if it is a regression problem, this OT might be your final result. Okay, so that is how you explain this specific recurrent neural network. Okay, it's an unrolled recurrent neural network. I think that is more straightforward for students to comprehend this figure. Okay, but it is not necessary to have such kind of structure. Okay, sometimes you have some variant. Okay, let's take a look at the first one, what we call many to one. Sometimes you have a lot of input x1 to xm, but you have only single output right here. It's okay. You can simply just put YM or OM, okay, at the end of your recurrent neural network to perform many to one problem. Okay? For example, you can use your malicious software, you can use the dynamic analysis result. So X1 will be the first Windows ABI call, X2 would be the second one, Xm would be the last one. And Ym, you can specify it is a malicious software or it is a benign software, right? Let's go many to one. And here we have one to many. For example, you can input X1 as the image. And Y1, Y2, Ym would be the caption. So image brings to the first cell and output the first word as your caption. And H1 brings, okay, pass the information of Y1 and X1 and to Y2. So when the second cell has been executed, it knows what has been outputted, which is Y1, right? And it will generate Y2. For example, a horse standing on the grassland. So Y1 would be a, Y2 would be horse. And the Y3 will be standing. That is because you have to bring the past information of Y and X by using H1, H2, so that the corresponding Y knows what exact caption should be outputted. Right? So that is one to many. And the other thing is more general, that is many to many. Translation. So X1, X2, XM is English, and Y1, Y2, Ym will be Mandarin. So again, we need to bring what has been translated by using H1 so that the cell knows which word has been translated and which word has not been translated. And there's X2, so what is the corresponding result of X2, which is Y2. So there are several different structures. Okay, so there's a problem that we simply just use the the notation is a little bit different, but it's okay. We use S right here. It's okay. The S stands for state. So we bring the state from the previous cell to the next cell. Okay, so the H right here is hidden. Okay, so sometimes we think that the state may lose some information because the sequence might be so long. So state cannot bring all the information to the next cell. So sometimes there are some problems. So here is a very popular. Here we will introduce three different popular structure of recurrent neural network. So the first one is the easiest one. Okay. So we take a look at this figure. That is the simplest one. So we simply just call it RNN. Okay. So here. So here. Here we have our current input. XS, XT, right? And from the previous cell, we obtain the state, which is the history of all the previous information, right? So very similar to what we draw in the dense network, okay? Here we have two arrows, right? So for every arrow, there should be a weight. So we have a weight right here, X, WX, and here's the WS. So the you have to notice that WT and ST minus 1, they are vectors. Okay? So the dot product WS and WAX, and we sum them together. Okay, so that means XT, and we perform a transformation by WX. s t minus 1 and we perform another transformation w s, and we add them together and pass them through an activation function, and we choose hyperbolic tangent right here. So that indicate we have different neurons, and which neuron should be activated or which neuron should not should not be activated. It all depends on the weight. Okay, so part of the neuron will be activated. Okay, after that, to output HT, sometimes there is a weight right here. So again, we transform the result of the nonlinear transformation by the activation function and perform HT, WH to obtain HT, and that is our output. And at the right hand side, there should be ST right here. And of course, that is a very simplified recurrent neural network. We simply just combine the information of current observation, the information of all the past information, and transform them in a high dimensional space and add them together and to perform a nonlinear transformation and output the value or pass the information to the next cell. That is the simplest one. Recurrent neural network. Okay, but we don't use that recurrent neural network because that is too simple. So most of the time, I think you have heard of this LSTM, long short term RNN. It is more complex. Okay, so I will explain how it works. Okay, so. Again, okay, we use this one. Again, there are some ideas which is the same. You need to input the new event at each cell, right? You have to output certain vectors at each cell. You have to pass the information, okay, which is the green one, from the previous cell and do some calculation in your own cell and pass it to the next cell, which is the green one. But unlike the simplest recurrent neural network, when you perform input, output, and try to calculate the history, they have some structures are designed, okay? And let's see. Okay, the first thing is that again, you have the input, right? XT. Okay, and you have the output right here, which is HT. Okay, and notice that the H in this version in LSTM, okay, HT will be output right here, and HT will be bring. Will be passed to the next cell as well. Okay? HT is not only used for output, it also used for pass information to the next cell. And CT right here, that is the history. And you can see that the old history is CT minus 1, and the new history is CT. And they have to change it according to the current input, right? So there's a transformation right here. Okay, times something and plus something, and it changes your CT minus 1, and a new CT will be generated. Okay, so that is the structure. And again, in this structure, there's a specific function right here that is sigmoid function, Since the convert function only output value between 0 to 1, so that is an activation function. So 0 means we do not activate this thing, and the 1 means we like to activate. So we give it another name called gate. 0 means we close the gate. No value will be passed through the sigmoid gate. 1 means, okay, we open the gate. So every value will be passed through this gate, and so on and so forth. So in RNN, the gate means it is a sigmoid function, activation function. Okay, so let's take a look at this one. We have XT, which is the current input. We have the previous output, HT minus 1. Okay, the first thing is that, like this, we concate XT and HT minus 1. That's the previous output and the current input will be concatenated together. And we have a new transformation, which is WF right here. So basically, that is simply just one linear combination of HT minus 1 and XT. And we pass it through a gate. So the name is called forget gate. Forget gate. That means how many things you want to forget. And we use HT minus 1 and XT to define how many things we need to forget. Okay? And here it is hyperbolic tangent. So that is the value we would like to output. IT is how strong we should output this CT tier. Okay, CT is the value we would like to output. It is from HT minus 1 and XT with a transformation W, C, and BC. But how strong we output CT tier? It is depend on the value of IT. Okay, so CT is what we would like to output. So right here, you can see that CT is our current output of this cell. CT minus 1 is the previous state, right? So the current state equals to how many past information I should forget plus how many information I should add with this strength. So if you can see, that if this FT equals to 1 and IT equals 0, that means when you pass the history information through this cell. If the factor right here is 1 and 0, that means you don't have to remember everything happened in this cell. You simply just pass all the information of previous cell and pass it all through this cell, and that's okay. But think about another thing. If the value is 1 and 0, and that means when we calculate this cell, we figure out that you should forget everything about the past information. You simply just use the current xt and ht minus 1 to come up a new value, which is ct tier, and pass and use this value as your current ct, your current state value. So it is some kind of weighted things that you can preserve the past information or add new information to CT. Okay? And the next thing is that, how about HT? So again, it's very simple. HT is used to is output, right? So we concatenate ST minus 1 and ST and use a new transformation and pass it through a gate, which is called output gate. And the CT right here will have a new activation function, and here's the strength for how to output HT. So that is the output gate and the activation function and the CT. And again, CT is from XT and HT minus 1. So that is okay. So basically we use HT minus 1 and XT to decide three different gate. One is output gate, the other one is called input gate, the other one is called forget gate. The structure is the same. They both concatenate HT minus 1 and XT and use a specific bias and weight and pass it through a sigmoid function. And we have three different values. Zero means no information should pass through the gate. One means all information pass through the gate. And the information is defined right here. We use HT minus 1 ST and hyperbolic tangent to create a new vector, CT. Okay, so we decide how many things should pass through this cell. So that is a very simple explanation of LSTM. And of course, there are some new structure, which is called GRU. Basically, it is a more simplified LSTM because it is good enough to use filter parameters. So as you can see that when it output is HT, it only use one single value, ZT, right here. So we don't need two gate to specify which output we should use. Okay, so it has a filter parameters, which is GRU. And basically, in current implementation, we simply just use GRU because GRU is more efficient than LSTM. Okay, so I think that is a very interesting blog. So make sure you take some time to take a look at this blog and make sure you understand how LSTM works. Okay. So next thing is this specific TensorFlow example. Okay, because we, I would like to introduce a very interesting thing. So we use the Google example right here. Okay, you can run this code in your Colab. Okay, the first thing that I'd like to introduce is that it's called the TFDS, TensorFlow Dataset. Okay, so make sure you take a look at this. And right here, we have a lot of category right here. So basically, most of the well-known data set has been included in TFDS. So basically, you don't have to you don't have to collect those data set by yourself. For example, the data set we'd like to show you is this one. Okay, we'd like to perform interesting application is that we read a lot of words from movie review comments, and we like to make a very interesting detector, or say predictor. It is either one or zero. Is that the review likes this movie, or the reviewer dislike this movie? So it is very interesting because we can use a very for example, those are tokens. Yeah, we have a lot of words, right? We input those tokens to our recurrent neural network. And no matter how, there is an output Y and it's either 0 or 0. So basically, we can use text-based data, okay? Because text-based data, they are sequential data, right? They can be processed by RNN. Okay, so so here, let's take a look how it works. Okay, so basically, if you use TFDS, you can simply just load the name, okay, and it will download the dataset. Okay, and we can see that there should be. Right here, this should be 25,000 review comments for training and 25,000 review for testing. Okay, so here is the example how you retrieve the data from that data set. Okay, you simply just use tag one, and you can see that here that is the text. This is a blah, 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 terrible movie, blah, 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 blah. And the label is zero. That means the reviewer does not like this movie. Okay? Here we have some hardware settings you can, but we will skip this part, okay? And you can see, we can take three of the data, okay? The first one is this, second one, third one. The result will be 110. That means two of them like this movie. One does not like. Okay, so now we don't analyze numeric data anymore. Now we analyze sequential data. And this sequential data, the first sequential data we would like to analyze is text. Okay, but as we know, text cannot be calculate. We mean you cannot add apple to orange or to banana. So basically, we need to transform the text-based data to numeric form again. Okay, so the first thing is that is text vectorization. It is a layer provided by TensorFlow Keras. Okay, the first thing you need to decide is the vocabulary size, which is your dictionary size. Because English word has, I think, more than 10,000 of vocabularies. So you need to shrink the size. So the size 1,000 means I only use a dictionary, which has only 2 plus 998 vocabularies. There's two specific words. The first one is padding. The second one is unknown. And the rest of the 998 vocabularies are vocabularies in your training data. So basically, you take the entire data set and you adapt the data set. It will calculate how many different vocabularies used in your training data set and rank them. And the first 998 vocabularies will be picked up. Okay? And two additional, one is padding, the other is unknown, will be preserved. And for the vocabulary, which is not in the first 998 vocabularies, will be presented as unknown. So here, after we adapt the encoder, okay, the encoder is the text recognition, okay, and you can see that the very first 20 vocabularies in this dictionary is that is padding, that is unknown, and that is the most frequently used vocabulary in your data set, which is the and of something like that. Okay, so here's the example. Okay, here is your first sentence, right? The snobs and the pseudo expert. Okay, the first vocabulary used right here is the, so this sentence will be encoded as two, because that's zero, that's one, and that's two, because two represent the, and that is lowercase. And the second word, right, is snob, right, snobe, but unfortunately, it is not in your dictionary because it is a infrequent word used in your database, training database. So this snub will be one because one is unknown, and so on so forth, so on so forth. Okay, and at the end, there are some paddings because we pad all the sentence to the exact same length. So that is how you represent your words by using text vectorization. And one of the important things is that you have to decide what is your vocabulary size. That means what is the size of your dictionary. Okay, so take a look at this thing. So you can see that lots of word has been replaced by this unknown token. Because the dictionary size we select right here is a little bit small. For English, I think the size should be 3,000 or 7,000, which is appropriate vocabulary size. But that makes your calculations slower if you use big dictionary size. But no matter, okay, now we have the training data like this, training data like this, training data like this. And then we perform, we like to create a RNN model to deal with the text, okay? So as you can see that was a great movie, right? It will be convert by the text recognition there to 5, 8, 3, 120, 35. And after that, there will be a magic embedding function. Okay? That embedding function has a has a weight, has a vertex right here, has a complex structure right here. But we will talk about word embedding next week. Okay, so you simply just think, okay, there will be a mapping, so we know what is the vector value of this 5, 8, 3, 120, and 35. There's a weight, it can magically convert the vector text vectorization result to a real vector. We will talk about several different methods when we talk about text embedding, okay? So that would be x1, t1, xt2, xt3, xt4, xt5. Okay? So as you can see that we have several different cells right here, right? That is the cell. So you can use GRU, RNN, or LSTM, no matter what kind of RNN you have. Okay, and you can see that here we have we don't have H0, right? So H0 is O0, right? Here's the H1, H2, H3, H4, and H5, okay? And in this structure, they use H5 as the output, which is HO, so that is the output. So you can see that the red cells and the blue links, they form a RNN. And actually you can use GRU or LSTM, which is fine. Okay. And I would like to mention some things that usually when we get such kind of text-based information, and you can think that when we output, okay, when we output H5, okay, let's put it in this way, okay. When we read this sentence, that was a great movie. For human beings, that was a great movie. You can read it in this way, right? But for machine, they can read this sentence in another way. That movie great was that. You can reverse it. So it is a very common design that when you use a sequential model, you can reverse it and analyze it again. So you can see that here, there is another line right here, and that's X5, okay, X5, X4, F3, X2, and X1. And you can see that there is another set of cells. They are connected together in a reversed way, right? And we can see that it is 0. We can say that's H5 prime, H4 prime, H3 prime, H2 prime, H1 prime. This H1 prime will be further used right here. H1 prime. Okay, I write it in by using H5 prime. So that is called bidirectional structure. So in this case, we will get H5 and H1 prime. H5 is obtained in this way, from left hand side to right hand side. And H1 prime is obtained from the right hand side to the left hand side. Because for machine, it really doesn't matter if it reads this sentence in this way or that way. Because sometimes information can be obtained more clearly in reversed way. So after that, we have a dense neural network and we perform classification we combine the information from H5 or from H1 prime and come up a classifier. So that is how we use this one. Okay. Again, we still use sequential model. The first layer is the encoder, which will transform your data to numeric data, integer data. And the second layer we will talk about them next week, which is the embedding. Okay, it will generate a vector which dimension is 64. And after that, we have a bidirectional LSTM. It has 46 cells. And after that, we have a dense layer. And after that, we have the result. So that is how you read this model. It is exactly the same as this figure. Oh, so make sure you understand that. So after that, it's okay. We simply just use binary cross entropy and make sure you understand what it's from log it means. And we perform addon optimizer, calculate the accuracy to train the training data with 10 epochs, validate the data using the test data. And you can see the accuracy will be 87%. Okay, if you perform your evaluation on your test data, the result will be 85%. And you can see that we have 10 epochs, right? And it becomes stable around somewhere here. So that means by reading this comment, this text, we can perform 85% accuracy of classification. Right? Even more. Sometimes we call it is a binary, bidirectional structure, right? Even more, you can, okay, take a look at this one. You can stack two bidirectional structure, which is written in this way. Okay, and you can perform some fancy layers like dropout 0.5. Okay, so after that, you can see that the accuracy increased a little bit. So that means the double layer of bidirectional actually works better. Okay, stop right here. Okay, so take some time to take a look at these collab files and try to run it by yourself. Okay, we stop right here.